Chapter 6 discusses how a Christian can cheerfully and joyfully surrender himself to death, conquer all bitterness of death, and how he can and should remain steadfast in the faith unto the end. 1. Now tell me, with what can and should I quiet the fear of death, that I may surrender myself so cheerfully and joyfully to my God? In former times, the heathen scholars taught that when it comes to dying, no better advice can be given than that a person takes fresh courage, scorns death, and remembers that now it cannot be otherwise, and that it will last for only a brief bad moment, and then it will be over with. They consider this to be a great art and wisdom. That is what the heathen king Agag did when he saw that the prophet Samuel intended to cut him in pieces. He came cheerfully to Samuel and said, "Surely the bitterness of death is past." Even today, we often hear the same from those who call themselves good Christians. When a person speaks of death, they turn up their nose and say that it is only a matter of courage and that it involves only one evil moment. Dear soul, those are miserable, fleshly thoughts. An imagined courage brings no comfort to the heart and has no hope of eternal life. Their heart is full of fear and anguish, and they do not know how to commend their soul to anyone. By contrast, the believing children of God have a much better medicine against the fear of death, a very certain art which is revealed from heaven, namely, true faith and heartfelt confidence in our Lord Jesus Christ. Whoever has this and clings firmly to Jesus has the real, genuine medicine against death and all its bitterness. Yes, my soul, what is there in death to be afraid of? You know very well who you are and what you are. Truly, you were bought with a price. What reason do you have to tremble before death? Behold, Christ is your life. Why are you fearful? To die is gain for you. Are you not sure of the way? Behold, Christ is the way and the guide to heaven. When you have that, then death cannot harm you. When you have Christ, you can lose nothing, even though body and life depart, for Christ stands by you in all things. Yes, my Lord Jesus Christ, thou hast died for me. Thou hast reconciled me to thy Father. Thou hast atoned for my sins. Thou hast swallowed death and earned for me eternal life. I believe this in my heart and cling firmly to thee. Therefore, in my heart, I have peace and joy, comfort and delight, and do not regard death so forebodingly. Yes, Lord Jesus, through thee I have forgiveness of all my sins and am righteous and pure before God. I have in him a loving, gracious Father, am his dear child, and am an heir of his heavenly kingdom. My Lord Jesus, I am thy possession. Thou hast bought me with thy blood and redeemed me from hell. Yes, thou art my brother, and I am a fellow heir with thee. For all that thou hast is also mine. Yes, I am thy beloved bride, thy delight and joy, thy treasure, which thou hast dearly purchased. In addition, I am also a temple and dwelling of thy Holy Spirit, through which I am sealed and assured in faith. Yes, the Holy Spirit has bound, united, and so firmly joined me with thee, my Lord, that I am bone of thy bone and flesh of thy flesh, and all creatures must perish before anything would separate me from thy love. For what can death do to me? Nothing more than to bring me closer to thee, my Lord Jesus. Therefore I regard death as nothing, but have life in my heart and speak of nothing other than life. For Christ is my life, and to die is gain for me. Yes, I say and sing with Job, I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not another. Lord Jesus Christ, thou knowest that I believe in thee, and cling firmly to thee in faith. Yes, I also know that I believe in thee, and find the sweetness of thy comfort. Yes, the foretaste of eternal life in my heart. Thou art in me, and I in thee. All that is thine is also mine, namely, life and eternal joy and gladness. What do I care about transitory things? If only I have thee, I have all that can gladden me here in time and hereafter in eternity. Away with all temporal pleasures, with all glory of this life and all temporal things. Lord Jesus, thou art my delight, my joy, my money, my goods. Thou art my honor, my glory, my splendor, my desire, and eternal wealth. I love thee from the heart, my buckler, my rock, my fortress, my deliverer, my God, my refuge in whom I trust, my buckler and the horn of my salvation and my high tower. Whom have I in heaven but thee? And there is none upon earth that I desire beside thee. My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. My heart has received such faith, such love, such ardor toward thee, my Lord Jesus, and thus I have been strengthened so that I neither fear distress nor death, for I am certain that all things, even death itself, must work for my best. Let my last hour come whenever it is thy will. I know and am certain that in thee and through thee I have life and complete eternal satisfaction. Come, Lord Jesus, come, thou faithful God, and bring thou me to my goal, for thou, the sting of death, hath trod, from all anguish relieve my soul. Bring me to my real fatherland, where I shall join the glorious band. Let me go in peace to my home. Amen. Thus a person can drive away the bitterness of death. 2. That does indeed bring life and comfort to the heart, if only I am able to remain steadfast so that my faith does not cease. Here you have a great guarantee from your Lord Jesus Christ, which is only good for you. For thus he says, All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. For I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. And this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all which he hath given me I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that every one which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. Dear soul, you hear these words from the mouth of him who is the truth. What comforting words they are! What joy and courage they bring to our heart! Here the Lord, who cannot lie, testifies to you and says, Your faith will not cease, you will not be lost, but will be kept steadfast unto eternal life. Again, the Lord says, I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. And again, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Likewise, he also says, Mary hath chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her. Note well, dear soul, how can the Lord assure you more beautifully, since he promises you that he will, through the power of the Holy Spirit, see to it that your faith will not cease, that no one will pluck you out of his and his Father's hand, and that the good part which is in your heart will not be taken away from you. Now you are certain, dear soul, both of eternal life and of remaining steadfast unto eternal life, that by his grace you will remain steadfast unto the end. He will not leave you, and you will not leave him. Therefore, take comfort and rejoice, and say with St. Paul, I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. And again, I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Lord Jesus Christ, Thou art my true and eternal portion, which I have chosen, and I am certain and convinced in my heart that it will not be taken away from me, O Thou great warrantor. Who will despair in Thee, O Almighty Shepherd? Who will pluck me out of Thy hand, O Thou loving Savior, who art love itself? Who shall separate me from Thy love? Thou art mine, and I am Thine. Thou livest in me, and I in Thee. Thou hast already implanted in my heart the foretaste of eternal bliss, and hast permitted me to experience many moments of joy. Yes, Lord Jesus, I feel the witness of Thy Holy Spirit in my heart, which gives witness to my spirit that I am a child of God, and Thine eternal joint heir. Thou art the vine, and I am a branch on Thee. Thou art the tree of life, and I am firmly grafted to Thee through my living faith. Thou art the bridegroom, and I, Thy trusting heart, am united with Thee, joined to Thee by an eternal, indissoluble covenant, which will be severed neither by distress nor death, by the devil, by fear nor by terror for all eternity. My Lord, my God, my refuge, my comfort, my desire, Thou delight of my heart, Thou joy of all my powers, how my heart burns for Thee! How shall I sufficiently delight myself in Thee? When shall I come and appear before Thy comforting countenance? O Thou most beautiful, most sweet, most loving, most kindly Lord, unto Thee I live, unto Thee I die. Dead or alive, I am Thine. I am completely assured, sealed, confirmed, established, and convinced in my heart that I am an elected heir of eternal salvation. Praise the Lord, my God, who hast assured and comforted my soul so well. Amen. 3. But what should a Christian do when he finds not only such joy of faith, but great weakness, anxiety, and trembling, and often even has doubts whether he is elected unto salvation or not? Such an one should on no account brood over his doubts and weaknesses, but consider what the Lord says: The kingdom of heaven is gotten by force, and the violent take it by force. Yes, he should consider the exhortation of St. Paul: I put thee in remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God which is in thee. He should also comfort himself in the salutary promise which the Lord spoke: A bruised reed shall he not break, and the smoking flax shall he not quench. He should revive his soul with the word of the Lord when he says, Be not afraid, only believe. And again the Lord says to the man sick of the palsy, Son, be of good cheer, thy sins be forgiven thee. Then too, dear soul, there is that which we experience every day. The more a person clings to God's word and considers its comforting sayings, the more comfort arises in his heart. But he considers especially the holy call of the Lord and his friendly voice: Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Just listen, my soul, at how charmingly and lovingly the Lord calls you, how he attracts you as a hen gathers her wandering chicks, and as a faithful shepherd gathers his wandering sheep. Remember that even now you are one of the weary and heavy laden, to whom the Lord's voice is directed. Therefore answer the Lord with an obedient heart that would gladly believe, and offer up unto the Lord a contrite, anxious, and broken heart. That will be pleasing to him, and he will not despise it, as he has promised: To this man will I look, even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit, and trembleth at my word. Do you not know, dear soul, that the Lord receives the weak in faith? Your weak faith is still true faith, if it only struggles, wrestles, continues, and does not cease, and clings to the word of promise. For that beloved man, Dr. Martin Luther, said, If God would not keep his promise, then our salvation would already be lost. But God keeps his word and does not lie. Therefore, even though our heart wavers, we can still take refuge in him who does not waver. For he says, I am the Lord who lieth not. And again, God's gifts and calling cannot be changed. So far, Luther. Know to this, dear soul, and cling firmly to the word. Let his word make you certain that even though your heart says a loud no, you should not let that make you afraid. For God is greater, and his word is much more certain than your own heart. But learn also to know the way of the Lord. His delights are with the sons of men. He loves and plays with them as parents do with their dear children. At times, he withdraws his hand a little from them and exercises them, not for their ruination and downfall, but in order that they might learn not to put their trust in themselves, but in God the Lord, who raiseth the dead and who is certainly able to strengthen the weak. He does not want us to be presumptuous, but wills that we should serve him with fear and rejoice with trembling. How things go with the presumptuous, who build on their courage and powers, can be seen even in St. Peter and in Thomas. No one knows himself as he really is. Only to God are we manifest. Therefore, pray to God always for a gracious rule and preservation unto the end. Be assured that if you have felt his comfort at any time, he will surely come again. If the Lord has ever gladdened your heart, he will surely do some more. Yes, even if you had never felt a single spark of comfort throughout your life, do not despair. Pray, believe, hope, be patient. The comfort of the Lord will surely come. It will not tarry, especially at the very end of your life. Consider the example of the Canaanite woman. See how the Lord played with her, how he even refused her three times. The first time, he remained completely silent and answered her not a word. The second time, he permitted her to hear him say that he had not come for her benefit, but for the children of Israel. The third time, he called her a dog who was not worthy of his comfort. What did she do? After the first time, in the face of his silence, she maintained a patient heart that could still wait and hope. After the second time, she placed before the Lord a firmly believing heart which enclosed itself in the word and wished to have a part in the promise. After the third time, she placed before him a humble heart and was glad to be a dog, desiring only the rights of a dog, namely, the crumbs which fell from the table. That is, she only wanted a little help, only a small spark of comfort. With that, both she and her daughter would have enough. In the end, the Lord could no longer restrain himself and poured out the full measure of his help upon her and said, O woman, great is thy faith, be it unto thee even as thou wilt. But if you say, yes, she was strong in the faith, but I am very weak, then you should know that our faith is like that of a wrestler. A wrestler always fears that he might lose and be weaker than his opponent. So also our faith. If he wrestles and fights, we think it will be too weak and will be defeated in the battle. But it is not so, for victory belongs to faith. It comes in its own way, for victory belongs also to weak faith. It will hold the field and be kept by the power of God unto salvation. Remember also the battle of the patriarch Jacob, how he wrestled with God and continued, not giving up, and said, I will not let thee go except thou bless me. Lord Jesus Christ, thou dost surely know that I believe in thee, even though with a weak faith. Yet with this weak faith of mine I rest all my confidence in thee. Extend thy comforting hand to me, and draw me to thee. My Lord, I am very weak. O increase my faith. O strengthen my confidence. Be not thou a terror unto me, my refuge, for thou art my only hope. Otherwise, where shall I go? Inflame the tiny spark in my heart through thy Holy Spirit. See, to will is present with me, but thou must bring it to fulfillment. Yes, Lord Jesus, thou art my life, my comfort, my salvation. When I have thee, I have everything. Now, indeed, I have thee, although with a weak hand. But I do still have thee. If my hand is weak, then thy hand is all the stronger. Oh, do not let loose of me with thy hand, so that I do not let loose of thee. Now, Lord Jesus, look on me as thou didst look on Peter, on Mary Magdalene, on the Canaanite woman, and on the patriarch Jacob. Scatter the darkness of my heart, and grant unto me a little spark of comfort. Here I am, a poor dog, waiting for the crumbs from thy gracious table. Here I move like a poor creature of the sea on dry land in my distress, and ardently long for the heavenly dew of thy grace. See, I am wrestling with thee, as did Jacob. O thou mighty Lord, enter thou into my heart. Grant thyself to me, for thou knowest that the victory will be mine. I will not let go thee, except thou bless me. I will not give up until the sun of thy comfort rises upon me. Lord Jesus Christ, thou didst pray for Peter, that his faith would fail not. Thou dost now sit at the right hand of thy Father, and intercedest for us. I believe and know that thou wilt also reach me, and grant that the bruised reed of my heart will not be broken, and the smoking flax of my faith will not be quenched. Thou sleepest not, my refuge. No, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. I know that thou hearest. Arise, my God, and command the violent storm in my heart to be still, and find the sweetness of thy word and holy comfort, and learn to trust in thee with all my might. In conflict I so weak must stand, my Saviour help in weakness. To grace alone myself commend, with heavenly strength thou wilt bless. When trials come, keep thou me firm, they shall not overwhelm me. Thou canst foresee that naught shall bring me harm. Thou wilt never forsake me. Amen.